Once you start taking the necessary steps to get to where you want to be, you're going to have success in terms of having peace of mind and just knowing that your efforts are going to get you there. So in you're already going to know that success is on its way. I have success where I'm at right now because I know I'm doing what I have to do to get where I actually want to be and what God has shown me where I want to be. What's poppin', people? Welcome back to my channel. In today's video, we're going to be talking about why a lot of Christians are scared of success and we don't really realize it. Or we do realize it, but we don't really know why. But before we do that, I'm gonna remind you guys, hit that like button, hit that subscribe button, share this video with a friend, and do not forget to let me know if you wanna talk about something specific in the future or elaborate on something that I did not in this video. But for now, let's get started. So one reason that a lot of us are scared of success as Christians, like in general, is because the world kind of has trained our mind to think that it's bad. Because when you think of success, you're thinking of the fancy lifestyle and the celebrities and flaunting on Instagram and all those things. And the flaunting isn't bad. The flaunting is bad, but having those things are not. Yes, the way you go about getting it can be a bad way, or if you become arrogant or you become like very greedy with your stuff, that becomes a bad thing. But as a Christian, having success, having fame, having money is not a bad thing. And because the world has kind of showed us what that looks like, is usually the opposite of a Christian lifestyle. So a lot of times when you're scrolling through Instagram, you see someone living their best life, but it looks like they're being very provocative, or they're getting drunk, or they're cursing up a storm, or they're being a flirt, or have all these people around them. Like, what kind of atmosphere are they in, you know? As a Christian, we see all of that, and it makes us think, how can I have this life if that's what the world is showing me? This is what it gets me, but I want to have success. I want the money. I want the fame. I want the nice car and a house, you know? I want those things. Nothing is wrong with wanting it. It's all in how you get it, and you kind of have to be ready to go for it. Because before I dive in, I want to point out all the people in the Bible that the Lord blessed and said that he's with them and he has favor on them, they were all wealthy. You think of Boaz, you think of Joseph, who was sold into slavery, but then the Lord made him second in command, which means he obviously had money and power. You think of Abraham, he had a lot of land. He was a father of many, many nations. He had money. You think of David. David went from, you know, being a shepherd boy to being a king. You're a king, you have money. So when you are faithful, when you listen to the Lord, when you're doing what you're supposed to do, he's going to bless you financially, and he's going to bless you in your life as a whole. So thinking of those four people that I just named, and you can even think of Esther. Esther, my favorite. She became queen by literally being herself and doing what the Lord told her to do, and she saved her people in the process. She became queen. She had money. She had status. She had power. So I don't really know where this narrative of a Christian person, a good Christian person, cannot have those things. When you can, it's just a matter of what you do with it and your mindset behind it. So one reason as Christians, a lot of us are scared of success is we're scared to get our hopes up. Especially in this Christian world, you know, it says try God and see, and you speak a thing, and you fast for something, and you're believing for something, and you keep doing it, and you don't get it. It can be very discouraging and very disheartening at times, because it's just like, okay, Lord, what am I doing wrong? Maybe this life isn't for me. I have done the fasting. I've done the praying. I've spoken into existence. I worship you like nobody's business. I don't care what people think of me. You know, I'm doing what you call me to do. Why have I not reached the level that I want? And it's because there's something missing. And what's missing is your belief that you can actually have it. So what the devil tries to do is when you're constantly believing for something and you have yet to get it, or you don't even see signs that you're going to get it, he's going to try to play mind games with you and make you think that you'll never forget it, or that's not the lot that the Lord has for you. So now you are trying to kind of reroute your own desires and reroute your own career and path in life, when you don't really have to do that. You just kind of have to keep believing. And the difference between a Christian success and the rest of the world, the people who are not Christians and their success, is the way we go about it. So what a lot of people do, well, they'll compromise morals and values to get the fame or the success that they have. Whereas us, we're not supposed to do that. We're just supposed to keep pressing forward. And that's what can be very disheartening and very discouraging at times, because you're wondering, like, okay, Lord, how long is it going to take? Like, how long is it going to be for you to answer this promise, or for you to answer this prayer? Like, does speaking things into existence even work? Why does manifesting for these people who aren't even Christians seem to work for them, but when I do it, it doesn't work for me? what am I doing? And because the devil slowly plants those seeds of doubt and insecurity, it makes us not get our hopes up. So when we do kind of have that sudden like urge to believe for something, it's almost like, all right, let me be guarded, let me be secure, let me get prepared to be disappointed, because what if God doesn't want this for me? When I've talked about in a previous video, the Lord would give you the desires of your heart as long as you delight in Him. I explained delighting in Him means you have a relationship. If you have a relationship, your heart posture, the Lord's heart posture. So whatever your heart's desire is already what the Lord wants for you. Don't let the devil play mind games. He plays them on me, tries to play them on me a lot, because I have big dreams, big goals, and I want to do things that no one else has ever done before. And I know my testimony is going to be something that no one else has ever heard. At least I haven't heard it anyway, not on mainstream. So when the devil's constantly coming for you, it usually means you're on the right path and he knows what's in store for you. He doesn't want you to reach it. So you cannot be scared to at least get your hopes up. You have to make an effort to increase your expectation, to increase your prayer life, and to just keep hope alive. It's a lot easier said than done. Been there, done that. It's a lot easier said than done. I still have my moments. But that is usually the stumbling block when it comes to having success, is we don't believe we can actually get it. Another thing is, you don't want to look stupid, especially if you're going out saying, oh, the Lord told me I'm going to be this, and the Lord told me I'm going to do this, and the Lord told me this. Especially when you put the Lord's name on it, you look even crazier, and then you know people are going to be watching you to see if it actually happens, and then if it doesn't happen in a certain time frame or whatever, they're going to think, okay, their God obviously lies to them, or they don't really hear from Him. So it's usually like that. There's that fear there when you're believing for a certain amount of success. You're afraid to put God's name on it, or afraid to say what God showed you or what God told you, because you don't want to look stupid and you don't want to make God look stupid. So you'd rather keep it inside. But while you're keeping that inside, you're also not increasing your expectations. You're not getting your hopes up, because now you're afraid of people, which leads into my next point. So I'm pretty sure, as you guys can see right now, the flow of this is usually fear. Like, the underlying reason for a lot of us being afraid of success is fear, and that definitely ties into a fear of people, fear of what they're going to think of us, fear of their judgment, fear of their opinions, fear of not having understanding, fear of not having friends. Because if you look at a lot of successful people, like I think of like the Beyoncés and the Kardashians of the world, it's just like, where do they find these friends? Where do they find these trustworthy, I can keep your secret, not spread your business kind of friends and kind of people? Because right now that's very hard to find. And with that said, a lot of us who have these aspirations and these goals and this career in mind and all this success that we want, we don't have people around us that are like-minded, and we need like-minded in all areas, like faith level, what you believe in. And not saying you have to believe for the same thing, but at least be willing to believe with you, because they know that if you put your mind to it and you put God in the mix, you're going to receive it. But the problem with a lot of Christians right now is we don't have a lot of like-minded Christians, because we have those people who think on a small scale, or we have those people who don't understand, why do you want something so grand and extra? Like, God isn't, doesn't flaunt, He doesn't do all that. He is God, yo. Like I said in the beginning, He blessed Daniel and Abraham and Esther. Like, He made them kings and father of nations and a queen. Why can't I have that? Like, I saw a post on Instagram and it really just irked me. So I'm just like, what? And it said, the world's goals versus my goals. And it was like a BMW and then me hugging and then a person hugging Jesus. It's just like, why can't I want both? Why can't I want the nice luxury car and make it to heaven? Why can't I want millions and billions of dollars and make it to heaven? Like, why does it have to be one or the other? And it's really because of that fear of people. You don't, as Christians, you don't ever want to give the wrong impression, especially, like I said before, how success is portrayed to us on TV. But that's just because that's what the world wants you to think. That's what the world wants you to do. You don't have to get drunk and go party all the time. You don't have to smoke everything. You don't have to be provocative. You can be a millionaire and live your best life and no one know about it. Like, you're kind of just doing you, and just because everything's on social media and it's in your face, you're thinking you have to do this. This is what success looks like. And if I have success, that means I'm not a real Christian, because I'll be doing things that people who call themselves a Christian aren't really doing. If they didn't say they are a Christian, you wouldn't know by their lifestyle. And we want people to know by our lifestyle we are Christians, but also we want people to know that you can live a very successful, financially free, you can go on vacations when you want to, spend time with this person, bless this person, give millions of dollars away, drive this nice car, and be a good example of a Christian, godly person. But if you're constantly looking at what social media puts on our face, we're gonna be scared of that because, again, it doesn't look like what the life that we want to portray. And this one is really for the women. I know for me, I struggle with this because it's just like, you know, the life I want this kind of career and this kind of car and this amount of money in the bank. And as a woman, especially living in a man's world, it can be like, you can almost stop yourself because of a man. Whether the man is there or not, it's just more of like, all right, when a man does come into my life, what if I'm making six figures and he's making five? I'll be okay with it, but will he be okay with it? Will he be intimidated? Will he think that I'm all that? Will he treat me differently, you know? And you gotta get over it. When God sends you the right man, the right husband, he's gonna like you for you. He's not gonna care about what's in your bank account. He's not gonna care about the car you drive, the clothes you wear. Like, he's going to care about you as a person, the heart, the mind, everything. So that's this tip. That's a little side note for the women. Do not think of a man when you're going for your goals. The right man will accept you as you are, flaws and all, money and all, lack thereof, or abundance and all. Like, he's going to accept you. So just remember that. And like I was mentioning earlier about having the real friends, you have all these celebrities who have these scandals and these secrets, and you're just like, where do they find the people to keep it for them, you know? And I think, like I said, with the Christian community, it's very hard to find like-minded individuals. Because when you find like-minded, godly Christian community, you're also looking for that trustworthiness. You're looking for those people who don't care about how much money you have. You're looking for those people who aren't going to want to use you for clout or aren't going to want to use you for your money. Yes, because they're connected to you, they're going to be blessed. That's literally what the Bible says. But you also want to know that they are going to be, they want to be around you because they want to be around you as a person. And again, you can't be afraid of that. You just have to trust that as long as you're doing what God tells you to do and you're following your heart and your mind, because he's going to speak to both, and as long as you know you're doing your part, God is not going to set you up to fail, and he's not going to allow things to happen to you. If y'all read Psalms 91, it says that not a hair will be touched on your head, you know, no lion or anything will trample over you. Like, you have to read that and believe that. And if you believe that, then you know that whoever is not meant to be in your life, God's going to remove them. I always say peacefully, because who wants drama? But if he has to do it aggressively, I'm just like, do you, because no one has time for the fakeness. So that's just another reason why a lot of us are afraid of success. We're afraid usually of people, the lack thereof in our life, or the judgment and the criticism. And another big one, the last one, is laziness. A lot of us struggle with laziness because we have this warped thinking as a Christian. If God wants it, he'll just bring it to me. Or if I'm supposed to have it, I shouldn't have to do all of this. When that's not the case. If you think of David, the Lord told David that he's going to be king of Israel, right? But David went through a lot to get there. Like, he had to develop work ethic, he had to develop, you know, dedication, he had to develop perseverance, he had to develop survival skills, he had to develop communication skills. Like, David had to go through a lot. And he had to work, and that was physical work back then. A lot of our work right now is pretty much mental. Like, we have to get our mental right first before we actually do the physical work. His work was pretty much simultaneous. Like, if I say that right? I think I said that right. Anyway, his work basically had to do at the same time. Like, he had to do the mental work and the physical work at the very same time. They were fighting wars back then. It wasn't just Twitter fingers, and it wasn't just going back and forth with words. It was like someone's trying to kill you all the time. Be ready, be on guard, have an army with you. That's what he was going through. And a lot of Christians, for some reason, we think that, okay, if it's meant to be, God would just bring it to me. I used to think like that. I would have all these goals and dreams and just kind of just wait for the opportunity to come. But then if the opportunity comes because of my laziness, I'm not ready for it. I'm not prepared. Like, I don't know what I'm doing. So the opportunity will usually never come. Or when it does come, I'll be embarrassed and missed out because I wasn't getting prepared. And in the process of getting prepared, you have to make a lot of sacrifices with your money, with your time, with your conversation, with your free time. Like, you have to make sacrifices. And I think especially in this world, we're taught to have a 9-to-5, go to college, do this, you know, spend your time with the Lord. You're thinking, when am I going to have a time for me? When am I just going to do what I want to do and not worry about anybody else or feel like I'm on anyone's schedule? Like, when am I just going to do me and be happy with that? When you are living this Christian life, doing you will probably never really happen in the way that you think it will. Only because we are meant to be servants. We're meant to give. We're meant to be a testimony to a lot of people. So yes, we're going to have times that we get to relax, but for the most part, which isn't going to be a bad thing, because once we get the mind right and the heart posture right, it's going to be a joyful thing and we're going to enjoy doing it. But the whole doing you is more of like, we're doing God's work. You know what I mean? I hope that makes sense. Like, the way we live, the way we communicate with people, our conversations, everything will be doing God's work. And it may, at the time, in the process of getting there, it may feel like we never have time for ourselves. It definitely feels like that at times. But the truth of the matter is, He's preparing us to live our best life. He's preparing us to get to that place where we can just say, hey, I want to disappear for a weekend, or I want to be gone for a whole 2 weeks. And we are able to financially sustain that, and we're able to have the freedom and flexibility to do that. But right now, if we're complacent with just a 9-to-5, and let me just clock in, or let me just go hang out with this person on the weekend, one, we're spending money that doesn't need to be spent. And two, we are basically wasting our time away trying to clock in, clock out. Now we're exhausted, so we want to go home and lay down. And the next thing you know, the day has gone away from us. And you have to build that mental toughness, and you have to build that like work ethic. That's a lot of work. It's a lot of work. It's a lot of work. So when I say lazy, I'm talking about in the actual sense, an actual meaning of laziness, like the things that you can do, but you're too tired to do, or just don't want to do, or you want to put it off or whatever. Lazy. And the other form of lazy is, you know, the sacrifices that you don't want to make. You don't want to sacrifice sleep, and you don't want to sacrifice taking time out to make a budget. You don't want to sacrifice your time with your friends, but in doing that, you are preparing yourself for the future. And I strongly feel like once we start getting on that track of just doing it and getting over how we feel like in the flesh right now and just doing it, I feel like getting there won't take as long or won't be as hard, because we're gradually developing good habits and a certain mindset. And I feel like God's going to bless it, because faith without works is dead. And I feel like once He sees you moving toward like the goal and moving toward what He wants you to do, He's going to bless that. And there's a verse that says, as they went, they were healed. And so as they moved and did what the Lord told them to do, the leprosy fell off of them. So saying that to say, you cannot be lazy and want to live a successful life. And yes, success looks different for everybody. It could just be, success could just be peace. Success could just be financial freedom. Success could be just having that family. Whatever success is to you, if you are not living in that success in your mind right now, it's your fault. That's it. Yes, God has a timing for everything, but once you start taking the necessary steps to get to where you want to be, you're going to have success in terms of having peace of mind and just knowing that your efforts are going to get you there. So in you're already going to know that success is on its way. I have success where I'm at right now because I know I'm doing what I have to do to get where I actually want to be and what God has shown me where I want to be. And you're going to feel more fulfilled in life. Like, I have these visions in my head of what I want to do and what I want to be. And I'm like, I'm not that person. I'm not that woman. What is wrong with me? Why am I not there? And the only person I can blame is myself. If it's because I let people scare me, or if I let people's words get to me, or if I let my flesh rule and just decide to be lazy for the day and not really be productive, that's all my fault. It is your life. If you're a minor, you're a minor. You have to do what your parents say. But if you're not a minor and you do have freedom and you have the free will to do whatever it is you want to do, your success is dependent on you. And as a Christian, we can have that success. We can have whatever we want in life. I firmly believe that, and I'm not letting anyone tell me otherwise. If you don't agree, I'm so sorry. This is the wrong channel for you. I hope you guys enjoyed this video. If you did, please give it a like, give it a thumbs up. And you don't want to miss Friday's video. It's my 5-day Friday where I break down key Bible and life principles in under 5 minutes. You're not going to want to miss Friday's topic. It's going to be in relation to this, but obviously a lot shorter. So in the meantime, in between time, I will see you next time. Bye.